Well, welcome and God bless you. My name is Paul Berry. I'm the senior pastor of Calvary Chapel, Santa Maria. I believe this is a unique opportunity for us on cable access TV to bring you segments of our regular services here. A service that is going to include not only the Word of God, line by line, precept by precept, but also that Word in the power of the Holy Ghost to change your life, even as I've seen it change so many people's lives in our congregation. I believe the Word of God has a unique power, a power that's far beyond the ability of speakers or churches that can affect your life, change your life. Romans 10 verse 17 says, faith comes by hearing, hearing by the Word of God. So as you listen to the Word of God this morning, in the power of the Holy Spirit, let it change you, let it change your neighborhood, let it change the place in which you work, let it change your family, let it change the things that the Lord wants you to occupy until He is the bridegroom, comes for His blessed bride, the church. And I pray that that's soon. God bless you. And all the multitudes were amazed in verse 23, and they said, could this be the Son of God? How long did they know that this man was blind and dumb? We don't know, but it must have been for at least a season. And the fact that no one up to that point, much like the lady with the 12-year flow of blood, she had attended many other physicians, and so far, with all the things that had been done to assist her, nothing had helped her with this 12-year flow of blood until she touched Jesus and encountered Him on His road to Jairus' house dealing with his dead daughter. Now, here's the thing about this. If you know better, why don't you come running to Jesus to reach out to Him? But if you this morning would say, you know what, I don't know what to say. I can't come with the words. I'm at a point where I'm dumb. And it's come to a point in my life where I just don't see Jesus. I don't see Him in my life any longer. Oh, Lord of glory, I pray this morning, come and touch that believer, Father. Come and touch them, Jesus. Throw Your therapy hands around them and love on them, Father, till they see You once again, till they speak to You once again. I don't think anything is more therapeutical than just speaking to Jesus. I really believe that, just speaking to Jesus. You've done that all this morning already in worship, I pray. Could this be the Son of David? Now, this bothers the Pharisees. Up to this point, of course, we've encountered many demons coming out of different people declaring in a very, heralding way, this is the Son of God. So far, they are the only creatures declaring that Jesus is God Himself. But now the multitude see, wow, with all the miracles that have occurred so far, we're in chapter 12 so far, and multitudes upon multitudes have come from all other lands, have come up to Galilee and to encounter Jesus, to touch Him, to be touched by Him, to perhaps have that therapy of a loving God, a comforting God, a graceful and merciful God, and they have not been turned away. It is said over and over, all were healed. No wonder this is the Son of David. Is this the Messiah that we have been waiting for? And Israel declares loudly that they believe they need a Messiah, they need a deliverer. You go to Israel today, and Israelis say, we need a deliverer, we need a Messiah. And there's coming a day, it tells us in Revelation chapter 1. Verses 6 through 9, that they will look upon He whom they pierced and they will be ashamed. You've chosen the right team.
You've come to bring glory to He who alone is the only Son of David. But more than that, He is not just the royal King, but He is also the King of all royalty. Now when the Pharisees heard it, they said, "This fellow does not cast out demons except by Beelzebub, the ruler of demons." Now, they have no argument with respect to the miracles that have occurred so far. There is no way for them to discount the fact that something miraculous has just occurred. Now, these Pharisees likely knew this fellow. They knew the fact that he was blind and he could not speak. And now suddenly, because of the loving encounter of Jesus, he not only sees, but he also speaks. Now, what would be the first thing you would say if you could suddenly see and suddenly speak? Praise the Lord of glory. Praise the Lord of glory. You must be the Son of David. Maybe the crowd was just repeating what this blind and dumb man was exclaiming now out of the power of the Holy Spirit. But the Pharisees say, we have no defense against that. So let's kind of pull the rug out from underneath this guy. They've tried this once before. In Matthew chapter 9, verse 34, it says there, the Pharisee said, "He casts out demons by the ruler of the demons." And now they are saying it again, and they are about to encounter both barrels of the God of all mercy. Now, I don't like that when it happens to me. And these Pharisees are going to go running off like a bunch of wailing dogs, you know? Let's look. Now, Jesus knew their thoughts, and that's exactly what God does. For the Word of God is living and powerful, and it is a discerner of even the thoughts and intents of man's heart. He knows every thought, every intent, every idea, every speculation, every imagination that gains entrance into your heart. It may not cross the gateway of your lips, but if it crosses the gateway of your mindset, the Lord knows about that, and He wants you, from 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 3 through 6, to bring it captive unto the obedience of Jesus Christ. Amen? I know that you do that. If you don't, giddy up, okay? They've tried this once before, but think about this. If the prince of demons was actually lending his power to the destruction of his own demonic agents, then there must be civil war in the kingdom of evil. And that kingdom is doomed, it says. Let's make sense out of this. If Jesus is casting out demons by the power of Beelzebub himself, let's think about this. Well, there's a lot of people that are demonized in the Gospels. Secondly, a demon has just been cast out. Thirdly, if the devil stands against himself, the Pharisees should still be praising the Lord because the devil's kingdom is slowly diminishing. If the devil is casting out devils himself, the kingdom of the devil is slowly diminishing. That's what Jesus said. If he's divided against himself, his kingdom will not stand. Let's think about this some more. If the devil stands for himself, and Jesus just cast out a demon, then Jesus must be opposed to the kingdom of the devil. And in fact, because the Pharisees could not cast this demon out, Jesus stands as someone greater than the Pharisees, more powerful than the demons, and is ruling against a kingdom that must in eventuality be completely destroyed. And we know that it is. Of course, we look to the Gospel of Revelation. And I say that because it's the revelation of Jesus Christ. And we see that in chapter 20, verses 1 through 3 and verse 10. It says there that the devil himself will be cast into a lake of fire and be determined to be tormented for all eternity without escape. This is the rule of the kingdom of God. There can be no other gods. There can be no other kings or kingdoms. Only the kingdom of Jesus Christ himself. Now, friends, if your Jesus is your Savior, you are a part of that kingdom. And in fact, you're even a part of the priestly king order of that kingdom. Now, Jesus reasons with them in verses 26 through 29. It says, if Satan casts out Satan, he's divided against himself. How will his kingdom stand? Makes sense. And if I cast out demons by Beelzebub, well then, by whom do your sons cast him out? Therefore, they shall be your judges. But if I cast out demons by the Spirit of God, know this, that surely the kingdom of God has come upon you. And what the populace just declared, that he must be the Son of God, the Son of David, must surely be true. Now, that should strike fear into these Pharisees. But they are so blind and so dumb. Do you see the connection here? They are so blind and so unwilling to declare Jesus is the Son of David, the Son of God, the great Messiah of Israel, the deliverer of all humanity, that they refuse, in their blindness and dumbness, they refuse to be changed by the presence of He who certainly, if they came to Him, He would throw His arms about them as well. Oh, how the Lord, just think in application this morning, how the Lord wants to throw His arms around the church of Jesus Christ today. How He wants, in fact, every pulpit to proclaim His kingdom above all other kingdoms. But that's not happening in America today. One thing that is the result of all these prognosticators of the election last week is that they're beginning to see in statistics that who voted, who didn't, and who voted for what among those who voted. And now are saying 40% of evangelicals in America, 40% of evangelicals in America did not vote at all. That's reprehensible. Where do you think you live? Iraq? Iran? I don't get it. This is a freedom purchased for you by men and women who have given up their lives, who stand in military uniforms in foreign lands to preserve the freedom of expressing your vote. And evangelical Christians, I read that, and I'm telling you, I began to weep. It broke my heart. It breaks my heart. Jesus says in verse 29, how can one enter a strong man's house and plunder his goods unless he first binds the strong man, and then he will plunder his house? See, Jesus came to the house of this demon in this man, and he gained entrance through the power of the name of Jesus Christ. So can we. We can enter the strong man's house, and listen closely, Jesus calls the devil a strong man. In other words, he is not someone to play checkers with. And so many ignorant people, ignorant young people today, mess around with tarot cards, with Ouija boards, with seances, with horoscopes, with things that they think these are just games. These are just fun little parlor tricks. No, they're not. You are opening a gate, a door to the presence and occupation of a demon within your life. If they knew that, surely they wouldn't make that choice. But so many still do today. Jesus says this very clearly. He who is not with me is against me. He who does not gather with me scatters abroad. In other words, there is no neutrality with Jesus. There is no middle ground with Jesus. There are no political moderates with Jesus. You cannot walk the fence with Jesus. Jesus said to the church of Laodicea, because you are neither hot nor cold for me. And I wish that you were either hot or cold for me. Because you are not. You are lukewarm, and I will vomit you out of my mouth. Wow. Wow. Now, I haven't recently thought of those that know not Jesus as in that condition. But friends, what Jesus is talking about are those that know who He is and are walking some moderate route with respect to whether they want to be hot or cold for Jesus. That's the worst condition of all. Jesus says, you are either with me or you are against me. Does that stir anyone up this morning? Stirs me up. Therefore I say to you, verse 31 and 32, this is where we'll close today, with an important correction for every Christian and a great warning for everyone that is not a Christian. Therefore I say to you, every sin and blasphemy will be forgiven men, but the blasphemy against the Spirit will not be forgiven men. Anyone who speaks a word against the Son of Man, it will be forgiven him. But whoever speaks against the Holy Spirit, it will not be forgiven him, either in this age or in the age to come. Now, this is a very, very grave warning. This is the first and only time in Scripture, in the Gospel of Matthew, in the ministry of Jesus, that He puts it in such exclusionary terms. It should have been a warning to the Pharisees, sufficient for them to stop what they were doing and plead with Jesus that they could see, that they could speak, that they would be released from this religious mindset. Ever been called, oh, Paul, he's got religion now. Oh, nothing breaks my heart more than someone to say, oh, Paul's all spiritual now. That was said of me at a high school reunion. Oh, Paul's got religion now. Praise God, I've got something that you don't have, because I know Jesus, and I wish that you did as well. Scripture has always described our God as a God of long-suffering, of forgiving and graceful, a merciful heart. Psalm 86, verse 5, for you, O Lord, are good and ready to forgive, abundant in mercy to all those who call upon you. Daniel chapter 9, verse 9, it says, to the Lord our God belong mercy and forgiveness, though we have rebelled against Him. Forgiveness, grace, and mercy are the essentials of the gospel of Jesus Christ. It is found throughout the New Testament, Ephesians chapter 1, verse 7. In Him we have redemption through His blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of His grace. 1 John chapter 1, verse 9, if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us of all unrighteousness. What does this say about our God? Our God has prepared this very moment to forgive you of every sin. Now, the warning comes very directly to everyone that's listening this morning, because Jesus says it in a very organized manner. First of all, He says this, blasphemy against Jesus, that's forgivable. Well, let's stop for a moment and talk about what blasphemy is. Blasphemy is attributing anything that God does to the devil. Anything that the Holy Spirit does to the devil. Anything that Jesus does to the devil. Anything the Father does to the devil. It's directing the praise of God and what He owns Himself to anything other than God. To man, to animals, to demons. That's blasphemy. Okay? Everybody good so far? Jesus says, you blaspheme me, it's forgivable. It's a sin, but it's forgivable. Blasphemy against our Father God, well, that's forgivable as well. And I infer this because Jesus said, my Father and I are one. But here's an interesting thing. He says, blasphemy against the Holy Spirit is unforgivable. Now, he says also in verse 32 that speaking against the Holy Spirit is unforgivable. Now this concerns me. Because I want to make sure that in my life as a Christian, I never speak in terms of who God is and lie about it. And in fact, when I attribute the things of God to something other than God, and when I speak about my God in a degree or a manner that is untruthful, in other words, it isn't something that comes from the Word of God. It's just what I think. It's just something I presume because it makes me feel better about God. Okay? That's blasphemy. It's a lie about who God is. It's a lie that promotes man above God, and that's blasphemy. You get the idea? Now, I know that Calvary Chapels for a long season have been very, very good and have almost made a profession out of spending many, many Sundays talking about other ministries, other churches, other theologies, and spending, and I'm going to say, wasting a lot of time trying to tell you why some other pastor, some other church, some other thing is of the devil. And I'm saying to you that those men should be shaking in their boots. If I think that every possible expression of the Holy Spirit is known only by Paul, and that I'm capable of declaring anything as being of the devil, then I'm thinking pretty highly of myself, and I'm committing blasphemy. Now, I want you to be concerned about this as well. I think that you've probably noticed in the 20 years that I've been here, I have never wasted a single Sunday talking about another church or another pastor, another theological mindset. I don't do a series on Mormonism. I don't do a series on Buddhist or Hindu theology. I don't do a series on Jehovah's Witnesses. I don't do a series on Joel Osteen or anyone else. Now, does that mean that those things aren't valuable? I suppose to some degree, in individual devotional study, those things are valuable. But I'm going to tell you something that's even more valuable, and that's focusing on Jesus Christ. Focusing on the blood and the power of the cross of Jesus Christ. You know that, and friends, you'll be able to discern everything else. But in a church that does not know the cross of Christ, does not know the Christ of the cross, they are incapable of discerning, and their eyes can be diverted. Every wind of doctrine can influence their lives. But friends, I pray that our church is a church of the Word of God and the Spirit of God. And I believe the Spirit of God brings discernment. But be careful with that discernment, because if you think that God is going to speak against His Holy Spirit, you are sincerely and gravely wrong. Be very careful about what you say concerning what the Holy Spirit does. Let's focus on Jesus. Amen? What is the unforgivable sin? Is it possible for you to commit that sin? And here I'll say, every sin is forgivable. Jesus says that. But friends, the most unforgivable sin is saying of Jesus that He's a liar, He's a cheat, He is a destroyer, He's a stealer. Because what you're saying about Jesus is that He's the devil. When you say, "I don't believe Jesus," what you're saying is, "I believe Jesus is a liar." Every time someone says, "Well, I don't believe in Jesus," in actuality what they're saying is, "He's a liar. He's a cheater. He has led millions upon millions in unfaithfulness. He has done more to harm them than He's done to bring good to them." They are attributing a satanic role to our God. That's unforgivable. Listen, we, unlike some other faiths, do not believe that all people are saved. It's God's desire that all would be saved. He desires that none would perish, but all would come to the saving glory and grace of Jesus Christ. I'm still astonished that He desired me and my life. I'm still astonished. And there's times when I'm astonished that he desired you as well. But here's the end of the matter. If you know anyone who has said of Jesus that he is a liar, or who will not receive Jesus Christ as their Savior, what in fact they're saying is the gospel is wrong. The Bible is wrong. Jesus is a liar. He gave untruths. He is the devil. Do you understand the connection there? John chapter 10 verse 10 says that the devil came to lie. Excuse me. The devil does not come except to steal, to kill, and to destroy. And if Jesus be not God, he came and he stole, he killed, and he destroyed all of us. But I believe that Jesus is who he says he is. And I believe there's a day coming when every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ alone is God. And I believe that you've said that as well. Have you, Christian, committed the unforgivable sin? I'm glad that you're concerned. I'm concerned. But let's come in prayer before him right now and understand this, that in the state of grace, in the blood of Jesus Christ, all manner of sin is forgiven because you believe that Jesus is who he said he is. And that's the greatest sin of all. Those that do not believe, or even worse, those that do believe and do not walk according to his grace. Church, my interest is not to shake you up any more than Jesus should have shaked you up this morning. Let's close our eyes. Let's bow our heads. This is a communion morning, and we're inviting our Sunday school classes to come in. We're inviting our pastors and elders to come down and to serve you the elements that will bring you to remember Jesus as God, as the Lord of glory, as the King of kings, the Lord of lords, who gave his blood and his body as a sacrifice for you. Lord, I'm concerned this morning, and I cry out to you, Father, that if I've committed any sin that is reprehensible, abominable, Lord God, that would be considered, if committed by an unbeliever, to be unforgivable, Father, I ask that you would forgive me by the blood of Jesus Christ right now. Wash me of that wrongdoing. Lord, I want to see you face to face. Lord, I want to continue to confess with my mouth the glory of the risen King, that Jesus is God, that he is the Son of David. He is the Son of God. He is my God. He is the Lord God Almighty. Open my eyes that I might see. Open my tongue that I might speak. This very morning, my Savior, my glory, above all other glories.
Well, I hope you enjoyed that broadcast. I pray that the Word of God affected your life and will go forth from your head to your heart and begin to affect your family, affect your neighborhood, affect your workplace. We welcome you to join us on Sunday mornings at 8:30 and 10:30, but only if you're not attending a church elsewhere in this community. I welcome you also to consider how the Lord would use you with this word and in his spirit to do something eternal in these last days. God bless you. Once again, this is Paul Berry, Senior Pastor of Calvary Chapel.